जय श्री माता जी। श्रीमद् देवी भागवत। इफ यू वॉन्ट टू नो हु आदिशक्ति इज, रीड देवी भागवत, सेड बाय हर होलीनेस श्री माता जी निर्मला देवी।
संकल्पम्। मम आत्मानः सहजयोगी कुटुंबानां आत्मोन्नति प्रीत्यर्थं मोक्ष प्राप्ति प्रीत्यर्थं साक्षात् श्री आदिशक्ति माताजी श्री निर्मला देव्यै पूजनं करिष्ये। द होली रिसाइटल ऑफ श्रीमद् देवी भागवत।
चैप्टर 2, एपिसोड 3-4। द स्टोरी ऑफ महाभिष एंड गंगा, द बर्थ ऑफ शांतानु, मैरिज ऑफ शांतानु विद गंगा एंड द बर्थ ऑफ द वसुस एंड द बर्थ ऑफ भीष्मा। The Rishi said, O blessed one, you have told us about Satyavati and Vedavyas, but one part of our request is still pending. How did Satyavati, who was Vyasji's mother, become the queen of Raja Shantanu? She was just a boatman's daughter. Also, she was not very beautiful and the odor of fish always surrounded her. How then did Shantanu, descendant of Puru and a powerful and illustrious king, accept her as his queen? Who was Raja Shantanu's first queen who gave birth to Bhishma, and why is Bhishma called a part of the Vasus? O wise Suji, you have already told us that Bhishma was very glorious and magnificent and was endowed with great strength. He gave his father's throne to Satyavati's son Chitrangad, and on Chitrangad's death he coronated the younger prince Vichitravirya. Bhishma was the eldest son of Raja Shantanu and should have had first claim to the throne. How did the youngest son become king? He was not insensitive to this fact that his eldest brother is the rightful king. Also, after Vichitravirya's death, why did the grieving Satyavati insist on the widowed queen's bearing sons? Why did she not have Bhishma crowned king? Why did the valiant Bhishma never get married? O learned Surji, you are the learned pupil of Vyasji. It should not be difficult for you to answer all our questions. We have renounced everything to assemble in this sacred grove and listen to your words of wisdom. Surji says, there was a king named Mahabhish belonging to the Ikshvak dynasty. He was a very truthful, dharmic and universal being. He had performed 1000 Ashwamedhas or sacrifices and 100 Vajpayee Yajnas, the last of the 5 Skrauta sacrifices enjoined in the Vedas, and impressed the king of the gods Indra. As a boon, he was ensured free passage to heaven. One day, King Mahabhish went to the abode of Sri Brahma. All the gods were in attendance on Sri Brahma. The holy river Ganga was also present. A strong gust of wind disturbed Ganga's raiments. All the gods present avoided looking at her and bowed their heads. But King Mahabhish fixed his gaze on her and she also slanted glances at him. They felt attracted to each other. Seeing this, Sri Brahma became angry. He put a curse. King, you are banished from heaven. Go and take birth as a mortal. After you perform enough virtuous actions, you will again merit access to heaven. For her misconduct, Ganga was also given the same curse. King Mahabhish and Ganga were very dejected and left Brahmaji's abode. The king began to review all the royal households in the mortal world and finally decided to take birth in the house of Raja Pratip of the line Puru. At this same time, the 8 Vasus, accompanied by their wives, had come to Guru Vasishth Ashram. There they had full freedom to go anywhere at will and enjoy the beautiful surroundings. The chief of the Vasus was Dhyo. His wife saw the sacred cow Nandini and asked her husband, to who does this cow belong? He replied, O fair one, this cow belongs to Vasishthaji. If any man or woman is fortunate enough to drink her milk, he or she will live for 10,000 years and remain ever young. His wife said, I have a friend who lives in the mortal world. She is the daughter of Raj Rishi Ushinar, a sage who was previously from a royal family or a kshatriya. She is very beautiful. Please let us take this wonderful cow, which gives an unending supply of milk, together with her calf to our ashram. We will keep her there till my friend gets the opportunity to drink this most auspicious and life-giving milk. Then my friend will be unique among mortals. She will never grow old and will not have to bear ill health. Even though Vasudeva did not have any bad intentions, he still acceded to his wife's request and committed the grievous sin of dishonoring his host Sri Vasishth. He stole the cow, and all the other Vasus became accomplices in this despicable act. After the cow was taken away, Guru Vasishth returned to his ashram after collecting fruits and flowers. His attention turned towards the cow, and he noticed that both the cow and the calf were missing. He began to search in the caves and in the forest. When he did not find them anywhere, he went into meditation and came to know of the grave and dishonest act committed by the Vasus. He uttered aloud, "For this sin of stealing, all the Vasus will have to take birth in this mortal world, and there shall be no doubt in this." Such was the curse pronounced on the Vasus by Guru Vasishth. Hearing this, the Vasus were very distressed. They immediately went to Vasishth ji, fell at his feet and tried to appease him. Seeing their pitiable condition, the sage who was most compassionate mitigated the curse. "All of you will be released from the curse after a year, but the Vasu who took the sacred cow Nandini will have to remain in the mortal world for many years." After being sentenced, the Vasu saw Ganga, the most supreme of all rivers, walking on the road. She was also very sad and dejected. The Vasus respectfully greeted her and said, "Devi, how will we, whose nourishment is only nectar and ambrosia, survive in the mortal world? It is very upsetting and disturbing to think that we have to be born as mortals. O Devi, we humbly request you to take human form and give birth to us. O auspicious one, there is a holy and pious king Shantanu. Please marry him. As and when you give birth to each of us, you may throw us into the water." Devi Ganga agreed. The Vasus left, Ganga also left. But she kept thinking about this promise that she had given. At about the same time, Mahabish took birth in the royal household of King Pratip. He was given the name Shantanu. The prince grew up to be brave and valiant, righteous and pious. When his father, King Pratip, performed singing of praises and prayers to Surya, he received as a reward a beautiful maiden. This maiden came out of the water and sat on the lap of King Pratip. The king asked her, "O beautiful maiden, without taking my permission, you have seated yourself on my holy right lap. What is your desire?" The girl replied, "O king, you belong to the noble lineage of Kuru. I wish you to marry me. That is why I have sat upon your lap." The king said, "That is not possible. The place that you have occupied on my right lap is reserved for my daughters or daughters-in-law. Therefore, O auspicious one, you may become my daughter-in-law. By your auspicious presence, I am sure I will beget a glorious and righteous son. You may marry him." The maiden accepted and left. The king kept thinking of the maiden in the forest as he returned home. Later, when his son Shantanu grew to manhood, the king related this incident to him. Then he directed his son to go to the forest, and if he met this beautiful maiden and she expressed a wish to marry him, he should not question her. He should marry her, and this would bring him lasting joy and peace. Sudji says, after giving his son all the necessary education, knowledge and instructions, he handed over the reins of government to his son and retired to the forest to pass the rest of his days in prayer and meditation and singing the praises of Bhagavati Jagadambika. Finally, he discarded his body and became entitled to a place in heaven. Then the full responsibility of looking after the kingdom fell to Shantanu. He became monarch of the whole world. During his kingship, all proceedings of the kingdom were conducted in an honest, righteous and fair manner. He looked after all the needs of his subjects. Sudji says, One day, King Shantanu went hunting in the forest along the banks of the river Ganga. He got a glimpse of a beautiful maiden wearing radiant garments and sparkling jewels. He was enchanted by this sight. He thought, "This must be the maiden my father spoke about. This is more than a maiden. She seems like the goddess Lakshmi in tangible form." He looked at her without blinking and could not remove his gaze from her. He was perplexed. The maiden also felt that this was the king Mahabhish in his new incarnation. She was filled with affection and she came and stood before him. The king was also filled with affection and spoke in a soft manner. "O beautiful and elegant maiden, what are you? A Devi, a human, a Gandharvi, a Yakshasni, a Nagakanya, or an Apsara? You have a very pleasing appearance. O radiant one, whoever you are, I request you to agree to become my queen." Suji says, Raja Shantanu did not know that this was Ganga herself, but she knew that he was King Mahabhish, who was now King Shantanu. Remembering their previous attraction towards each other, she smiled and said, "O great king, you are the son of King Pratip. I am aware of who you are. Which maiden would be so foolish as to refuse the offer of marriage to you? But there is a condition. Once you promise to keep that, I will marry you. Whatever actions I do, whether right or wrong, you must not use your position to prevent me. You must also not scold me or use harsh words. You are the most supreme monarch, but if you ever break this condition, I will have to leave you and go far away." The Vasus had already got a promise from Ganga. Also, being aware of King Mahabhish's love for her, she decided on this strategy for her present human form. King Shantanu accepted the condition and gave a solemn promise. Gangaji married him. She became the queen of the world's most powerful and virtuous king. They lived happily in the palace and the surrounding gardens. Then, Gangaji gave birth to a boy child who was actually a Vasu. She immediately threw the child into the waters of the river Ganga. She repeated this each time a baby was born. After she had thrown 7 boy babies, the king became anxious. He began to wonder how to preserve the dynasty and posterity. Could it be that his wife was something evil in disguise, as she had already drowned 7 children? He was afraid to interfere, as then she would leave him and go away. She was now due to have her 8th child. He somehow felt that this child was special and he did not know if he would have any more sons in the future. After much deliberation, he decided in the interest of the dynasty to exercise his authority as king. The 8th child was the Vasu chief Dhyo, who had stolen the cow Nandini from Guru Vasishtha. When the child was born, Shantanu stood before her and pleaded, "O most delicate one, you have a holy radiance in your face. I am your servant. My prayer to you is, please give the boon of life to this child. I will care for it. You have already killed 7 sons of mine. Save this 8th child. For this reason, my head is bowed before you. You may ask for anything else, and however impossible it may seem, I will give it to you. But please understand that I have to preserve my lineage. Those who are learned in the Vedas have said that a man who has no child is unfortunate and does not find a place in the heaven. So please let this 8th son of mine live." In spite of king's pleas, Ganga took the child and went towards the river. The king exclaimed, "O evil and sinful woman, have you no fear of hell? If you wish, you may stay or you may leave. But let this child remain here. You are trying to destroy our clan. I can have nothing to do with you." Ganga said, "O king, it was also my wish to keep this child alive. But you have broken your promise. Therefore, I cannot stay here. But know this, I am Ganga. I had come on this earth to help the Devas complete an undertaking. A long time ago, Guru Vasishtha had cursed the Vasus and banished them to the mortal world. They were very distressed, and at the time they met me, they requested me to give them a human birth. To accomplish this, I married you. Please believe me. It was those same 7 Vasus who took birth through me. Now they are released from the curse. This last Vasu will remain as your son for some time. I give him to you. Enjoy him as your son. He will be known as Gangeya and will have unequal strength and valor. I will take him to the same place where I met you. I will nourish him till he is grown up, and then I will return him to you. Because, O King, without a mother, a child cannot grow or be happy. Saying this, Ganga took the child and vanished. King Shantanu remained in his palace. He was in deep sorrow. The disappearance of his wife and son gave him endless grief. He ruled the kingdom, but the clouds of despair always hovered over him. Many years passed. One day, King Shantanu went into the forest to hunt. Gradually, he reached the bank of the river Ganga. He noticed there was very little water in the river. He was amazed. He spotted a young boy playing in the sand. He had an enormous bow and he was shooting arrows from it. King Shantanu was astonished. He could not realize who this boy was. He could only stand and admire the great strength and accuracy with which the boy was wielding the bow. He spoke to the boy, "O most pure child, whose son are you?" The boy was engrossed in the bow and arrow and made no reply. In a few moments, he vanished. The king was stunned. It suddenly dawned on him that this might be his own son, but now what to do and where to go? He calmed himself down and sat on the banks and began to sing the praises of Devi Ganga. The Ganga appeared to him in the same radiant form that he had first seen her. He said, "O Gange, who is this child that I just saw? Please show him to me." Ganga said, "Rajendra, he is your son. I have looked after him up to now. He is the 8th Vasu. I am handing him to you. He will be a great ascetic and will be known by the name Gangeya. He will be unshakable in his meditation and religious pursuits. I have instilled in him the knowledge of the Vedas and the art and science of archery. He has complete knowledge of everything. He is well versed in interpretation, significance and discretion. He is most holy and pure. Whatever Guru Vasishth knows, this boy has already imbibed. You are a great and famous king. Take him and experience the joy of being his father." She brought the boy and gave him to Shantanu, then she vanished. The king's face shone with delight and he was experiencing great happiness. He made the boy sit on his lap and kissed his head. Then he put him in his chariot and drove towards his palace. On reaching Hastinapur, he celebrated his son's arrival with pomp and grandeur. He consulted priests and astrologers for an auspicious date. All the subjects and ministers were invited, and in their presence, he anointed Ganganandan Bhishma as crown prince and heir to the throne. King Shantanu was completely satisfied. Thoughts of Ganga left his mind forever. Sudji said, "O Munis, I have told you all the details of the birth of Bhishma and Ganga's sojourn on this earth. This entire episode took place because of the curse on the Vasus. Whoever listens to this story gets all his sins washed away. There is no doubt in this. This narration is very holy, auspicious and filled with divine principles of the Vedas. I have told it to you exactly as it was told it to me by the great Ved Vyasji."
The Holy Recital of Srimad Devi Bhagavat.
Jai Shri Mataji.